Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you have decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled, The Role of the Church in the Community. And this is lesson number 9 in that series for August 27 of 2016, entitled, Jesus Ministered to Their Needs. Jesus ministered to their needs. Well, that ought to be something worth our thinking about. We've got a lot of interesting stories from the experiences of Jesus and some modern stories that will pique our interest, I think, as well. So we ask you to join us as we begin with a word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, it's such a privilege to think about you, to talk about you, to talk about what you have done for us and what you did for people when you were here on this earth. May our thoughts and words be an inspiration to those who might be listening in, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this lesson will give us multiple examples of how Jesus and his disciples and others in more modern times have reached out to the poor and the needy and the helpless to meet their needs. Now, I like this quotation from Ellen White. This is actually found in the book Steps to Christ, page 11, and going on to the top of page 12. He, Jesus, went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed by Satan. There were whole villages where there was not a moan of sickness in any house, for he had passed through them and healed all their sick. His work gave evidence of his divine anointing. Love, mercy, and compassion were revealed in every act of his life. His heart went out in tender sympathy to the children of man. He took man's nature that he might reach man's wants. The poorest and humblest were not afraid to approach him. Even little children were attracted to him. They loved to climb upon his knees and gaze into the pensive face, benignant with love. Well, a retired Seventh-day Adventist woman, let's compare a modern story. A retired Seventh-day Adventist woman in an African country did not wish to stop ministering in retirement. Her community needed healing because of the ravages of HIV/AIDS. The most urgent need was that AIDS orphans didn't have adequate nutrition. In 2002, she and her church started feeding the children in the community a solid meal 6 days a week. They started with 50 children and as of 2012, were serving 300 children per day. That led them to start a preschool, and now 45 of those children are attending. Other services, including distributing clothing from address, sharing vegetables and maize from a garden that they maintain, and taking care of the sick. They started a skills development program for women who teach one another skills that help them earn a living. This demonstration of the love of Jesus spawned a new church. There were 5 members in the beginning, and as of 2012, 160 were attending. God provided means for building an orphanage and a new church building in 2012. So, what do you think of that? Sounds like a good idea, right?
Yeah.
Let me just ask you a theoretical question. I've asked this class a few times before, and I think the first couple of times I asked it sort of stunned people. But think about it. What would happen today if we're almost across the street from our huge Loma Linda University Medical Center? What would happen if an angel, or even Jesus himself, walked into the medical center and healed everybody and discharge them from the hospital?
There'd be a lot of people out of work. And well, they would not be happy about that.
Well, okay, let's think about that for a moment. The first question I want you to think about is, how would it be reported the next day in the newspaper?
We'd have every video van outside the place, all kinds of stuff going on.
But what would they say? I mean, you know, we have a very critical media these days that aren't inclined to believe in miracles.
No, but they're pretty good at filling in, aren't they? Quite often.
What would they say?
I don't think there would be any problem, because what you described there is what everybody imagines, that Jesus would go through and heal everything, and it fit the narrative of any anybody. It's the ones that go over and do things a little bit different. They're the ones that get in trouble. And I think it would be a little different than that if Jesus actually came through.
Okay, now I'm going to go to the next question. Diane said maybe everybody would be out of work. Where do you suppose all the sickest people from all the surrounding hospitals would be the next day?
Right here. There's no end of patients. You could empty it out. There'd be more. I mean, this.
Everybody would want to be here. Everybody would want to be here.
So if it filled up the next day, why? What good did it do?
Well, the people who are sick are gone home.
Well, I know.
It matters to them. They're healed.
Well, I know, but...
Well, that would be definitely a good show, wouldn't it? Have all these people come and be healed. But that's what everybody come and see. I don't think you'd stay and listen to him, would they?
That's a good question.
That's a really good question. Would anybody stick around and listen to what he might have to say?
Be interesting to watch, but
well, I
is that going to happen sometime?
The reporters would go to whatever the, you know, they would come to him and start asking questions, you know, because if he was the one. Now, if it was an angel who just went through and then was gone, then that's a whole different.
Then what?
There's no focal point, no focal person.
Yeah.
There's a lot of issues that would come up. I wonder if it would do any good to even do that, just in the way that you described.
Okay.
I would think.
Do you think any newspaper reporters went to the orphanage and so forth of the African lady we read about?
Probably 2020, or some, you know, U.S. News agency would maybe go and do a story about all of that. I have no idea what they would do in the local.
Do you really think that would look like a miracle, or could you explain that some way?
Well, I think we forget there are some genuine people, non-Adventists out there that believe in God and prayer and angels, Catholics, probably some of the Baptists. There's a lot of people. Yeah.
Yeah, the question is how would everybody respond? How would the community respond? They would be talking.
The traffic jam for sure.
Well, do you think something of that magnitude, not exactly like that, but something of that kind of magnitude, even what the lady did in Africa, something of that kind of magnitude could happen in here or in other developed countries where we have all our medical care organizations and all that kind of stuff? Does that mean that all the opportunities for doing miraculous things sort of are gone?
Well, do we really need to do that here? We have foster care systems for orphans. Mm-hmm. We have for homeless, for people who are, let's say, homeless women with children. We have systems, and here in this California we do anyway, money that's available for them, food stamps, so or other sources, and even our own Diane works down here at a place that she refers to the station, and they feed people all of the time, and you know, so and we're not the only ones. There's Baptists that do these kinds of things. I have an acquaintance who at Christmas time I went up and helped. They have at their local Adventist church. They have every Wednesday night. They have a nice dinner for the homeless in the area, and they were telling me that although Wednesday is their night, there is different organizations that there's a place that those types of people can go every day of the week. Mm-hmm. So it's being done in all kinds of ways, the voluntary efforts, individual efforts like different groups and the Dorcas societies, even in some of the smallest churches they do things. And then we have our whole government is very philanthropic, if you look at it. That's the thing, many of the things we do. Some would say a little too philanthropic. So
there's a famous story in the Bible that you're all familiar with. Jesus just arrives from crossing the Sea of Galilee, people are thronging about him, trying to get his attention and so forth. And the leader of the synagogue comes rushing in, "My daughter is dying, come fast." And Jesus starts off, and of course he can't make very fast progress because there's people crowding around him. And suddenly a woman reaches out and touches his garment, and she's healed. How do we feel about interruptions? Do you like being interrupted? I sometimes say that my job is a one continuous series of interruptions.
I saw that. why would you even bring an interruption into your mind? I'm trying to think. Why do you even bring that in?
Well, I'm bringing it in because it was part of that story.
Changes the focus.
Just because he was going somewhere and somebody touched his...
Well, no, he was... First of all, he came...
I know it was an interruption, yeah. But why do you frame it that way?
Well, because a lot of people are very annoyed at interruptions. Are we annoyed at interruptions? Is that the right response? I mean, is that the way we win people, is being annoyed if they interrupt us?
Well, Jesus wasn't annoyed.
No, that's why I'm asking.
Well, that's why I was wondering why you even bring it up. Well, because he didn't even go that direction.
Your term interruption here is some interruptions it's not that they're just inconvenient. They just are a nuisance. They're interruptions.
Yeah.
You know.
Well.
And there's no productivity in this case. This interruption. This was an interruption where there was opportunity.
Yeah.
Not all interruptions are necessarily opportunity. I think that's kind of what Gary is kind of.
Well, that's kind of how I looked at it. It was an opportunity there. I just never looked at it as an interruption before.
We were in our day, we're working in a different paradigm. Now I'm talking the more helping the sick and the infirm and the likes. Getting back to your earlier question. Those of us who have had anything to do with this hospital, be it as a professional or a patient, you have to believe there's angels walking around this place we don't see. Mm. Now, in Christ's time, he was right there, as close as we've been getting to it of late. And I'm talking more in our own area, Los Angeles, San Francisco. We've been doing it in mission excursions, but we've helped hundreds of people. We have all the different specialties come in. That is something new that we haven't really done en masse.
Mm-hmm.
But it's similar to what Christ did 2,000 years ago.
Why do you think Jesus... Diane, you were going to say something earlier. Go ahead.
Well, what you're terming interruptions, as a nurse, I just consider those, you know, new set, you know, prioritization. You know, which is the most urgent thing, what needs to be done right now, and priorities change based on situations.
That's fine, except when it's your responsibility to make sure by the end of the day that everything is done.
Yes.
it's a bit of a problem. So why didn't, when this woman just reached out and touched his garment and was healed, why didn't Jesus just keep on going? Why did he stop and make a big deal out of it?
Yeah, he was healing whole villages.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, there's more than just an opportunity for physical healing here.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
There's some kind of an intimate awakening
mm-hmm.
that is occurring here. The person is doing. In the end, the person does more than just touch something.
Okay, let me read a couple of other verses. These are familiar stories also. I mean, pretty much all the stories in Jesus' life were very familiar. Look at Mark 10, starting with verse 46. They came to Jericho, and as Jesus was leaving with his disciples, now this is the very end of the ministry of Jesus. This is on Friday, 1 week before his crucifixion. Okay? And they're traveling with a large crowd, and they're traveling this road from leaving Jericho on their way up to Jerusalem. A blind beggar named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting by the road. By the way, what does Bartimaeus mean?
Son of Timaeus.
Son of Timaeus. So they, so
sort of Bar means son.
Yeah. Was sitting by the road. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, Son of David, take pity on me." Many of the people scolded him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted even more loudly, "Son of David, take pity on me." And if you read the Greek, I mean, when he thought there was a possibility somebody was paying attention to him, he just let loose with his shriek. I mean, he wasn't going to be quiet, that's for sure. Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called the blind man. "Cheer up," he said. "Get up, he's calling you." He threw off his cloak, jumped up, and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked him. "Teacher," the blind man answered, "I want to see again." "Go," Jesus told him. "Your faith has made you well." At once he was able to see and followed Jesus on the road. So?
So what kind of faith was this?
Well,
I mean, there's lots of people that Jesus isn't here, but they still communicate. They want to be made well and...
Faith healers.
Yeah, so don't they have faith when they're praying here? What is this faith has made? Why is faith made him?
I've debated about whether I should raise this question, but let me just do it right now. There are four times in the Bible when there was a lot of miracles. And of course one of them would be creation, and we understand that's an unusual situation. The second one temporally that happened was the plagues on Egypt, which weren't all good miracles, but in other things connected with that. Then the third one was the days of Elijah and Elisha. And then finally, the days of Jesus and the disciples. So can you think of any common theme that would run through those four situations?
Well, they're desperate circumstances.
Okay, desperate because of?
It was a hand-to-mouth existence.
Mm-hmm. It's a dark. The vicissitudes of life are against you.
Okay, well, let's set aside creation because that's obviously an unusual situation. Mm-hmm. But Egypt, Elijah, Elisha, and Jesus—those are some of the times of the very lowest possible faith. The lowest possible listening to God in the whole Bible. So there are people always preaching, well, if we just had a little more faith, we would see more miracles. No, in the Bible, miracles happened when there was very little faith.
They were sort of used to get people's attention.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if that's true, why did he find so many people that had so much faith? And he granted it.
Well, did he find people with that much faith, or did he go out?
The blind man did something that was not appropriate. He didn't know what to do. There was the only thing he could do. He knew that he was there somewhere, so he starts yelling.
Yeah.
Starts yelling really loud. And
does that take a lot of faith?
Yes, it would. I would think that the emotional circumstances right there, mm-hmm. probably people telling him to shut up. He's supposed to be quiet, like he always is, and he just went ahead and just shouted out because he knew this is his only chance.
Why do you think that took a lot of faith?
I think it was desperation.
Yeah.
Desperation takes faith. Sometimes.
What kind of faith are we talking here? There's a guy that the word is out that he can do these things, mm-hmm. and so. Well, Bartimaeus, it just happens to be here in the neighbor on the street when he happens to come by. So he just had faith that he's doing it every place. It seems like when we think a person ought to have faith, that it ought to be faith in that Jesus is God or something like mm-hmm. that. And it appears here I don't know. It doesn't seem to me like this fellow had whatever kind of faith we're ascribing to him.
Could there be an inference there that is not said? We've discussed before that Christ generally spent most of the night praying and had a fair idea of what was coming.
Yes.
Maybe he knew more about this man than we realize.
Yeah. Well, I think that's very possible. I think that's, in fact, I think it's true. Well,
it's not practical for us, though.
Well, my question.
Well, that's a question. Why isn't it practical for us?
Yes. Because you don't think how God much would... do you pray, and then you know what's going to happen the next day?
Well, my question
well,
is.
Well, that's what you just said.
No, I know.
He looks at his calendar. It
looks
full.
At, okay, yeah. I guess a doctor would look at his
and
calendar.
Then to pray to find out what's happening, you just look
okay,
at the calendar.
But that's not prayer. That's looking at an appointment book.
Okay. Well, let's take another example. You know the story of the guy lying beside the pool of Bethesda, or more probably it should be Bethzatha, not Bethesda, but never the mind. Here he is, and this is in the early times, the early part of Jesus' ministry. He's walking through Jerusalem by himself. It's a Sabbath. And he walks through this pool, by this pool, which is not too far from the temple. You can still see it. And he walks by this thing, and he wanted, Ellen White says, he wanted to heal everybody there. What do you think would have happened if he'd done that? He walked through villages and healed everybody in the villages.
I think the crucifixion might have been speeded up a bit.
Yes. Yeah. Well, he hadn't had a chance to say everything he needed to say yet, that's for sure. But, I mean, you know.
Sometimes I wonder, though, if that happened, would they kind of give credit to the angel that moves the water around? He really did it one day.
Yeah, well,
ooh,
what
point.
The story, you need to complete the story so readers who are listeners and viewers who are not acquainted with the story
okay,
as
well,
we are. But
it doesn't,
I mean, it's like the guy, he just said, in response, you know, well, I can't, you know, I just can't get to the pool. That's why.
Well, Jesus picks up probably the most seriously ill person in the whole place. And he walks up to him. The guy has never seen Jesus before, doesn't have any idea who he is.
Oh, okay. So where's the faith here?
Yeah, okay. Do you want to get well? Do you want to get well? Now, obviously he didn't know Jesus personally, but don't you think he probably had heard about him?
Do you think he knew who he was talking to?
Probably not at that moment, no. He said, his response is, sir, I have no one here to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. When I'm trying to get in, somebody else gets there first. And Jesus said to him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. And there's where the faith comes. Immediately the man got well, picked up his mat, and started walking.
I thought it was like your sins are forgiven.
Not part of this story. There's something interesting I'd like to take just a moment to talk about. Look at, if you look at my Bible, you'll notice it says, there's verse 3 at the top of the screen there if you're looking. A large crowd of sick people were lying in the porches, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed, and all of a sudden we're to verse 5. What happened to verse 3? The last part of verse 3 and the verse 4.
Re-editing, I believe.
Probably in the King James, but it's not in...
It's in the King James.
That's what I said, but it's probably not in that text there.
It says the earliest manuscripts do not contain the remainder of 3.
Yes. Well, here's what it says. The end of 3 says they were waiting for the water to move, and then verse 4 says... because every now and then an angel of the Lord went down into the pool and stirred up the water. The first sick person to go into the pool after the water was stirred up was healed from whatever disease he had.
Talk about a lottery. Boy, that was pretty
cruel. Yeah, what about that?
Pretty cruel, wasn't it?
Is that the way you would expect God to behave?
No, and I think Ellen White says it was thought.
Well,
some places.
You think it might say that? Let's look and see if we can find it.
Well, if it wasn't happening... there weren't some results. Why did those people hang around all the time? I mean, it's not like they came in the last three weeks because they heard about it. The impression is that they're there year after year. The story is there year after year, so...
Okay, so what do you think they hung around there?
Could have been their only hope.
Well, that's a possibility, but there's another reason.
Kind of like a day camp. What else are they going to do? They can't plow fields or herd sheep, so they might as well hang around some other people as miserable as they are.
If you really believe that an angel is going to stir the water, and every once in a while it moves a little bit, who's going to be the first one in?
The more, able-bodied, most able-bodied. Able-bodied.
Exactly. And they're going to go home saying, I was healed, I was healed. And so, what do you expect? Well, so here's what Ellen White says. At certain seasons, the waters of this pool were agitated. It was commonly believed that this was the result of supernatural power, and that whoever first, after the troubling of the pool, stepped into the waters would be healed of whatever disease he had. Hundreds of sufferers visited the place, but so great was the crowd that when the water was troubled, that they rushed forward, trampling underfoot men, women, and children weaker than themselves. Many could not get near the pool. Desire of Ages 201.
Was it the pool very deep?
No.
They still have it over there, don't they?
Is yeah,
it,
but
it's probably filled in.
I mean, yeah, it's mostly filled in. Yeah, so I don't know for sure how deep it was back at the time. But no, it wasn't deep. These verses shouldn't be in there. How did they get in there?
Some editor.
Well, probably what happened was this: if you knew the story of, if you knew Jerusalem, what was going on there, you wouldn't need those verses. You would know why people were there. But what if you had never been to Jerusalem? You'd never heard of the Pool of Bethesda or Bethzatha. Why are these people? You'd say, why are they gathered there? And it's probably someone after a while said, well, there's a lot of people reading this text who've never been to Jerusalem. I'll put a little note in the margin saying, you know, people gathered at the pool because of da-da-da. And later, as it more and more people were reading the text and fewer of them had been to Jerusalem, and maybe eventually the whole place is completely destroyed in AD 70 and you can't go to Jerusalem, someone said, well, we better include that in the text. So the question is, should you think of those verses as inspired?
Well, they answer the question that the sick man says in verse 7, Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me. Without those other lines, you go,
what?
What's going on here?
Yeah, exactly.
You know? So it helps to clarify that, and you wish there were clarifying statements in a lot of other verses. Other
yes, places. Wouldn't that be nice? But why do you think Jesus bothered to ask these people, you know, what do you want me to do? Why did Jesus say to Bartimaeus, what do you want? Another man, what do you want? Why would he ask that? I mean, wasn't it obvious?
Well, he could see so many needs. He wanted to focus on one. And he knew the heart. I mean, he knew they were. What they were going to ask, but
yeah,
it is good to know though what you want to do. If I don't know, there's people that kind of lay around all the time, they don't know what to do,
mm-hmm.
and there's other people that say, man, if I could only do this, that, or the other thing.
Could one say that humanity hasn't changed a whole lot? This is Bible times. We see this kind of thing going on in Spain and Portugal as grottos, that we'll just say that. Really isn't a whole lot of difference, except from our perspective, Christ is not there.
I had the privilege of a couple of years ago, of visiting Lourdes.
Yeah.
You've all heard, I'm probably not pronouncing it correctly, but just thousands of people just streaming past the place where supposedly the vision of Jesus was seen, and on stretchers and in wheelchairs and candles. You buy a candle and some people have bought great, huge candles. I mean, they stand 5 feet tall or something. I guess if you buy a bigger candle, you're more likely to be healed. I don't know. Come out the other side and they're still in their wheelchairs and you wonder,
Yeah.
But
if we applied the issue that you raised to prayer, though, you could have the same thing. You know, why should I ask? Jesus already knows what I need, so why communicate? And he does know, but he dialogues. Yeah. There's something about expressing it, saying it, asking him.
Was that a way of stimulating their faith? Saying, you know, speak up. You know, what do you want? Well, one of the things that Jesus did remarkably well and very cleverly was to listen.
Ken, are you intimating here that we should be more definitive in our asking?
Yes. I am.
Mm-hmm. Not be so nebulous in our prayers, but if there's something we...
Well...
Something we desire, and that's, I'm speaking of something other than just a new Buick,
yeah,
that it's appropriate to, you know, speak up.
Yeah.
Can I say something about that? Because I have a theory on that. I think that when I pray for or about something or someone or whatever, I really believe that I open my mind and my heart to influences from God, mm-hmm, that perhaps there are things that I can step in and, you know, help ease the problem, or that I may not have been aware. I mean, things were in front of me and I just didn't notice them. Mm-hmm. I just didn't pay attention to them. But when I'm focused on a prayer request or some of these kinds of things, then I'm much more aware of the kinds of things that God's probably putting in front of me all the time. I finally notice.
Well, here's the thing. When I was a child, it was very common, and I grew up doing this, praying for the missionaries and the call porters.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
How do you know if he's done, if Jesus, if you're praying such a broad, nebulous thing as missionaries and call porters, how do you know that God has done anything?
Faith.
But if you pray, yeah, right. But if you pray for a specific thing, and then something happens, that's a reason for strengthening your faith.
Yeah, but that leads to trouble.
It does? If something doesn't happen?
No, because when it happens, then you know it works.
Yeah, what
and
an amazing
then,
thing.
Then what do you do with that knowledge?
Mm-hmm.
Or what if it doesn't work? Does that shatter your faith?
Well, if you got the faith, it works. We learned that. So, and you know, the Lord is, it appears to me, the Lord is constantly trying to hook you in more and more and more and more.
Let's hope so.
So, every time you know, pretty soon there's responsibility that comes along with all
exactly
these answered prayers.
Well, Ellen White one time was praying for a group that were about to leave to be foreign missionaries. Now, you don't have to be in that situation to have these prayer be appropriate for you. She said, to these our friends who expect soon to go from us to other lands, I wish to say, remember that you can break down the severest opposition by taking a personal interest in the people whom you meet. Christ took a personal interest in men and women while he lived on this earth. Wherever he went, he was a medical missionary. We are to go about doing good, even as he did. We are instructed to feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and comfort the sorrowing. That was in Review and Herald, November 11, 1902, and quoted in Welfare Ministry 162.
Well, that's pretty specific.
Yeah.
This last weekend, the nurse that was my father's office nurse in Hangzhou got her PhD, and she graduated this weekend.
I was there.
Yes, I was so proud of her. We were all so happy for her. I think that my parents were just amazing people in terms of just loving people. And at one point in time, we call her Liana. She goes by Yang Li Li in China. But Liana had said to my mom, there are so many people that were just trying to convert me. She said, but you just loved me.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, I got baptized when you were out of the country because I wanted everybody to know that this was my decision and this wasn't something that you had talked me into or you had done the influence, that this was my own decision.
Mm-hmm.
And for her then to go ahead and stay in Hangzhou and stay at Sarenren Shah and continue to add to, you know, the good things that are happening there. I
marvelous.
Think that was a real good example of some of that.
And you may know, or maybe you don't know, that they have requested, and it's being very seriously reviewed, to start a graduate-level school of nursing, the first one apparently in China. when she would be a key person.
She would be a good one for it.
Yeah. Well, did Jesus know about the people he healed before he got to them?
This is a really interesting discussion that sort of, you know, takes a left turn here. Did Jesus, you know, what's the whole issue of foreknowledge? Does he, you know, how much does he know ahead of time? How much does he not know ahead of time? If he knows everything from the end, from the beginning, you know.
I think that's pretty, that answer's pretty easy there, because he prayed with his father every day. And there's no reason why the father couldn't communicate something to him. I don't think he had to figure it out on his own. I think that's...
Gary was kind of making fun of me there last night, earlier today.
No, he wasn't.
Is there any reason why God couldn't do that for us? Well, look at a couple of verses. Look at Mark 2, verse 8. At once, Jesus knew what they were thinking. So he said to them, why do you think such things? This is, of course, the story of the paralyzed man. So... Jesus immediately knew what they're thinking. Now, when I was younger and I read a verse like that, I thought, well, the reason he knew, of course, was because he was divine and he just automatically knew all these things. But I now realize that Jesus didn't exercise any powers that we couldn't exercise if we had the same kind of relationship to God as he did. Ellen White says that. And think about the story with the woman at the well of Sychar there in Samaria.
I see.
Jesus said, you've had five husbands. Yeah,
I think Christ was a very bright man. We know that he was that way from childhood. And he was a very keen observer. And living in the conditions that he was raised in, he would have learned a lot about that very early on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In the Ministry of Healing, she says, Christ in his life on earth made no plans for himself. He accepted God's plans for him, and day by day the Father unfolded his plans. So should we depend upon God that our lives may be the simple outworking of his will. As we commit our ways to him, he will direct our steps.
Very good. You know, what page is that?
About 478-ish, okay. Somewhere there. There's more to it there, but then.
The thing about the young man who was carried on that stretcher to Peter's house and they couldn't get in, so they climbed up on the roof and dug a hole in the roof and let him down. This is what Ellen White says about that. The palsied man was entirely helpless, and seeing no prospect of aid from any quarter, he had sunk into despair. Then he heard of the wonderful works of Jesus. Okay, does that have something to do with faith? He was told that others, as sinful and helpless as he had been, healed. Even lepers had been cleansed. And the friends who reported these things encouraged him to believe that he too might be cured if he could be carried to Jesus. But his hope fell when he remembered how the disease had been brought upon him. So there's part of what he feared, that the pure physician would not tolerate him in his presence. Yet it was not physical restoration he, the paralytic, desired so much as relief from the burden of sin. If he could see Jesus and receive the assurance of forgiveness and peace with heaven, he would be content to live or die according to God's will. And of course, you know what happened. What was the Pharisees teaching about sickness?
Wasn't it caused by sin? All sickness was caused by sin.
So if you were healthy and well-to-do, you were obviously a saint. And if you were sick and poor and so forth like that, you were not a saint, okay?
You know, there are people who claim to heal, mm-hmm. and people hear that, and we can even watch it on TV, and people become convinced they have faith in this. Mm-hmm. So, what's the difference? Why, I mean, if they have faith that they can be healed, why?
Could you have faith in someone other than God?
Well, they claim to be from God.
Well, there are the people who had...
I'm not arguing.
Peter did some healing. Mm-hmm. And Paul did some healing. And,
do you
and
think
Eli-
they,
Elijah and
do you think
Elisha
that they,
did some healing.
Do you think those people convinced the people they healed that it was their power that did it, or did they make it very clear that it was God's power?
Well, that's their point, isn't it? That God's with me. Mm-hmm. That's where all my power is, because God is with me. So I don't know if...
However, if you look at some of those TV channels and look in the faces of some of those folks, I'm not too sure they're focused along the lines of Christ.
Yeah. Well, think of the story of Dorcas or Tabitha. Remember that she lived in a small town of Lydda, I believe it was, and not too far from Joppa, and Peter was in Joppa, and this lady died. We don't know what she died of. And the people said, "Oh, Peter's in Joppa. Get him quick. Bring him over here." And what happened?
He fixed her up.
Peter walked into the room and took her by the hand and said, "Get up," and she did. And, I mean, we can read back in the Gospels where Jesus told his disciples, "Go out and raise the dead."
So why did they think Peter could do this?
Well, I mean, I think it's because he'd done it before.
Yeah.
And Jesus had done it before, and they knew it.
So faith is based on what you've done before?
Yeah, it's got to be a first time.
Well, and that's part of the question. What is faith based on?
There's evidence. It's not wishful thinking.
Yeah.
True faith would be
based on evidence.
Evidence, and your faith grows as you relate to somebody. You know, you might, if you meet a stranger, you might not trust them, you know. But as you spend time with them, your faith grows.
So all these people that Christ said had faith, you'd be able to find some point where they found evidence to have that faith.
Do we have any evidence in the Gospels for that point? Do you remember what Jesus said? What happened?
You can always trace that they found some evidence somewhere.
Well, my point is, when Jesus went up with his three disciples to the Mount of Transfiguration, and they came down, and the other nine disciples had not been able to heal that boy, what did Jesus say?
It doesn't come out except by fasting and prayer. This kind.
Mm-hmm. What does that tell you?
Well, maybe there was a problem that required that.
Okay,
because it looks to me when I read that they were all pretty jealous that they took those three up to the with Jesus, and they left everybody else behind. Mm-hmm. And there might have been some jealousy going on, and if they would have known that and sat down and fasted and prayed and asked for forgiveness on that, they probably could have started healing.
Right. But let me ask you a question. Here we are, living in the 21st century, Seventh-day Adventist church members here. Is there opportunities for us to reach out to help? Say, for example, even in this program, if we help somebody understand some doctrine of the Adventist church or some teaching of the Bible, are we increasing their faith?
It's done right. Hopefully, yes.
Well, if we speak of Jesus frequently and we talk about what he's doing in our lives, that can be something that increases their faith. Mm-hmm. If they see him working in our lives.
Jesus had some very interesting things to say about how Christians should stand out. Remember John 13, verses 34 and 35, "And now I give you a new commandment, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another." Now that's a tall order. But he goes on to say, "If you have love for one another, then everyone will know that you are my disciples." Does that mean no one else in the community is loving?
No.
I hope not.
I don't think so.
Unless of course we think Jesus wasn't telling the truth, in what way do Christians stand out?
I think this is a really good question, because I've been looking over this and I keep thinking, so what are the implications of what Christ did in the community, what Christ did in, you know, in the day-to-day lives of people. What are we doing, and what should our mission be, and what kinds of things can we do to be like Christ in that situation, in these situations? Does our church have a role or responsibility in this area? If so, what are we doing about it?
Is there a possibility of having love without being connected to Christ in any place, anyone? Even people
true
I have,
I don't think so.
Even people I have never heard of him, but they, yet they kind of love. I'd say any kind of love. I mean,
but what about? I'm thinking specifically of two people that say they were non-Jews that put their necks on the line every day the Germans occupied France, France, and they saved hundreds of Jewish kids.
Yep.
And even utilize Catholic sisters and priests amongst some of their buildings and stuff. That's some kind of love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It really is. In answer to your question, I think so. Yes. Answer to your other question, I think we Christians often are more likely to help out. There's certainly not enough of us doing it. We wouldn't still be sitting here talking about it.
Yeah.
I really think that God puts love and reaches out to people whether or not they acknowledge that that goodness that is in them comes from him. I've had a number of friends who were atheists and they're just, you know, there's no God, all of this. And I really believe that God puts good things in people's lives. And it isn't dependent on whether or not they earned it. Mm-hmm. And so whether or not they acknowledge that these things come from God, I believe that all good things come from him.
He sends his, causes the sun to shine, the rain to fall on the just and the unjust. And then Paul in Romans talks about doing, you know, those who do things, the Gentiles do these things, they keep the law because it's written on their hearts, not because they really understand it from a Jewish standpoint.
That seems to fly in the face of Jesus' statement, which I just read. I mean, if there's a lot of other people out there loving, and in what way do the Christians stand out?
Hopefully more loving.
Well, maybe the purpose of the Christian is something more than just to be loving. Maybe there's a message. Maybe there's
love
a witness.
Love is what binds us together, so maybe he's trying to draw them in as well through their loving.
A broader basis.
Shared experience.
Amy Sherman is someone who's a lady who's done a lot of studying of churches and their reactions, their behaviors. She describes three styles that church can use in serving its community. The first style she calls the settler style. It focuses on meeting the needs of the community around your church. So you move in, or you're there, you are, and you try to meet the needs of the people right around you. The second, the gardener style, means developing ministry ties with the neighborhoods outside your church's immediate area, as gardeners view their gardens as an extension of their home. So you go out here and you do something there, and you go over here and you do something there, you go there, you do something there. So that's another type, a gardener style. And sometimes several churches can get together and do a project. I'll talk about that in a moment. The third, the shepherd style, is serving one targeted population rather than a specific geographical neighborhood. So there are people who reach out to orphans whose parents have died of AIDS. It would be a good example. And I can tell you that I'm very happy to be part of an organization where seven churches of different denominations have partnered together to run a large pantry at the community health center where I work. And it serves thousands of people every week. What kind of an outreach would that be? You think that's an appropriate outreach?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Does the church need specific, defined missions?
I think the people who are putting those into action might need to match up their own personalities, their own styles, their own commitments, their own reasons for doing some of these things. I mean, I know exactly where I fit in that, and mm-hmm. you know, one out of three, there are two of them, that the settler, the gardener, no, but the shepherd style, for me, the commitment for to homeless women mm-hmm. and helping them, you know, fulfill God's plans for their lives is probably my strongest commitment,
yeah.
much more so than a gardener style or a settler
yeah.
style.
Very good.
Is that a what Diane just said? Is that a is that kind of succinct folkness to help others? How did you say that, Diane? Help others
In a particular group.
Well, but to help others find a way to fulfill God's purpose for their life.
Yeah. Now, where would we get some guidance? We, of course, we've got the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy we can look at. Hopefully, we understand something of what's going on in the community around us. We have some idea, at least, and hope. If we don't, maybe we ought to do some surveys of what the community needs are. And then the church members. I mean, it wouldn't be a good idea to ask you to, you know, somebody who's never had any experience to go out and conduct an evangelistic series. That's not what their specialty is. So part of what you need to do is recognize what skills you have available in your church.
And it comes back to the quote that I read about how Jesus didn't plan his life. He went to the Father, and God out, you know, just showed him what he was to do. And that's, she says, that's how we should approach it too. So it all begins with a personal responsibility of coming to God and saying, what do you want me to do today?
What I'm interested to see your interpretation of that. Is that happening in the morning during your prayer, or is it during the whole day? I think it's more of the whole day. At the end of the day, then you find out what the Lord was leading you to do. I'm not quite sure if you pray in the morning, I know exactly what's going to happen today, and then you go do that very same thing and get it done. I'm not so sure if that's what's meant by it when Ellen White says things are unfolded for you. I think they're unfolded as you go along, not necessarily at the prayer.
I think there are people that maybe are closer. Like the people that say, I knew I wanted to be a minister since I was a child, or I wanted to be a doctor. Some others don't get that.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. It's something I have pondered, but and can be developed. It depends a lot on our talents, too.
Well, I know a few people that wanted to be doctors, and they were sure that God was leading them that way, and they never turned out to be doctors.
I know, things change. No, you're right.
So things unfold as the day goes along.
We've just got a few minutes left. Let me read you another passage to see how this fits in. This is Mark 14, starting with verse 25. Once when large crowds of people were going along with Jesus, he turned and said to them, those who come to me cannot be my disciples unless they love me more than they love father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and themselves as well. Those who do not carry their own cross, I wonder what the disciples thought of when he was talking about crosses at that point in time, and come after me cannot be my disciples. How does that fit?
Well, didn't Paul carry a cross? We know he had an ailment. We don't really know what, but he worked under duress.
Well, that's a big statement of priority, isn't it? Priority is to your Creator. What good is everything else without doing that?
We talk about crosses all the time as Christians because of what happened to Jesus. Before that happened to Jesus, did they even think about crosses?
Well,
why would they even think about a cross?
I heard they were all over the place.
Well,
that's
not until a lot later. It wasn't all over the place in those days.
Are you sure? I thought the Romans did that all the time, way before Jesus came around.
Well, I'd like to see that documented. I haven't.
No, I can't give it to you, I guess.
Well, when we undertake a project, one of the things we have to think about is, do we have the skills? Do we have the ability? Do we have the people? Do we have the money? God doesn't want us to launch into projects which we're not capable of doing. I mean, I've seen people start off with, oh, we want to do some great, huge thing, and it never goes anywhere.
Actually, I'm thinking of, and we're running short on time here, I'm thinking of two guys in the Adventist church, a fellow by the name of Sutherland and McGann, and my wife took them down to Tennessee to this worn-out rock pile and said, you know, you need to start a school here, and so on and so forth. And McGann, I think, made the statement something along the line that faith is, faith is undertaking something in which, you know, there appears to be no real hope,
possibility, yeah.
And this proposition is such a thing. So,
but it worked, didn't it?
Well, and there's every reason to believe they had some divine resource directing them there.
But the point is, my friends, every one of us has access to divine resources. Why don't we do more? I'm going to say, what do you think about this? The Lord Jesus is our example. I'm reading again. This is Gospel Herald, Review and Herald, and Special Testimony Series B, but there are other places where it says something similar. The Lord Jesus is our example. He came to the world as a servant of mankind. He went from city to city, from village to village, teaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing the sick. Christ spent more time in healing than in teaching. As our example, Christ linked closely together the work of healing and teaching, and in this our day, they should not be separated. In our schools and sanitariums, nurses should be trained to go out as medical missionary evangelists and so forth. In another place, this would be Desire of Ages 350, it's a lot more easily accessible. During his ministry, Jesus devoted more time to healing the sick than to preaching. Why do you think that is in the last few seconds we have?
I think we need to be careful about always holding the idea before us that we're not doing enough.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Adventist Church has had some marvelous stories of people who've gone out and dedicated their lives to reaching people in other parts of the world, and for that matter, we're reaching out to people here. So the question of this lesson really is, what's your opportunity? Our kind and loving Father, once again, we thank you for this opportunity to think about the words that you have preserved for us in Scripture, to think about the miracles you performed. We don't have the ability to perform miracles, but we want to be more accessible for your guidance, for your leading to doing the things that you want us to do each day, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.